Thanks a lot. It's a pleasure to be here with you today, although not quite in person. So I'm going to talk about Coulomb and Risque gases. Actually, maybe the name is not that accurate because they are not always gases, but anyway, that's the usual name which is given to these systems. What's known and unknown. So when I wrote what's known and unknown, first I mean what's known and unknown from the point of view of statistical mechanics. And furthermore, I mean more what I know and don't know. Okay, so I will explain to you what I think must be true and what I think has been proved, what I think has not yet been proved. But I have to stress that I am not a probabilist, I am not an expert in these systems, and I am not a physicist either. So I would be very happy if you could interrupt me at any time. First, if you have questions about what I'm talking about, but also if you think that you can just add some precisions and comment on what I'm saying. So please do not hesitate to interrupt me. I mean, it doesn't matter if I don't go up to the end of the talk. So what are we talking about? So we are talking about these gases. So you should think that it's a family of point processes over RD of Gibbs type. So this family of point processes is going to depend on a few parameters. The first, of course, is the dimension of the space D. I will always think that we work in dimension 1, 2, or 3, but in principle, one can look at any dimension. Why not? So the most important parameters are S, beta, and rho. Okay, so rho here is the average number of points per unit volume, or if you like, the density. So it's a point process over infinite point configurations over the whole space. And then we are going to fix or choose, if you like, the average number of points per unit volume. Now what defines these point processes? Well, it's the fact that the points are going to repel each other through an homogeneous pair potential, which during the whole talk is going to be denoted by Vs of X. So it's just one over the the norm of X to the power S. Okay, so here it's the usual norm in RD when S is positive. It's exactly the same when S is negative, except that we put a minus in front. And then when S is equal to zero, if I take S equal to zero, then the previous definition would give me just one, which is not very useful. So what I do is I do an expansion of the Vs at small s, and I see that the first term is minus log x if I start at positive s, and so I retain the first non-trivial term, so Vs is going to be minus log x for s equals zero. Okay, so this is the parameter s, and we are going to let s have any value in this talk. The last parameter is beta. Beta is 1 over the temperature, and beta really controls the amount of randomness or correlations in your point process, with the idea that when beta is 0, it's just Poisson, and everybody is just IID, and when beta is infinite, or close to infinity, if you like, this corresponds to having a temperature going to 0. In this case, the points get more and more correlated, and actually, at zero temperature, it could be that if you know the position of finitely many points, then you could deduce the positions of all the points. So you see, it is extremely correlated. Okay, so beta is controlling randomness. S is the homogeneity of our potential. And now, because of this homogeneity, it turns out that there is some scaling in the problem. And we will always be able to choose rho equals 1 if we like. And then beta is replaced by beta rho to the s over d. Do you see my mouse? Yes. Okay. Which in the physics literature is usually called gamma. So in this talk, I will often just assume that rho is 1 and then use beta as my only parameter. But probably I should rather call it gamma. So now some comments about S. So you have to think that S controls the repulsion between the points in your point process. When S is very large, as you can see, this potential is very divergent at the origin, diverges very fast, and so it means that there is a very strong repulsion between the points. So it's very strong, but it's local, because on the other hand, at infinity, this potential is decaying faster and faster when you increase S, and therefore there are weak interactions between the points at large distances. Okay, so large S means very strong repulsion when they are close, but then they don't really see each other when they are far away. Actually, when S is infinite, you see, if I take S going to infinity, then I will get plus infinity when X is less than 1 and 0 when X is larger than 1, so I just get hard spheres. So hard spheres, this means that the point can never be at a distance less than 1. Or 2 or whatever, or actually 1. And however, when they are at a larger distance, then they just don't see each other at all. Okay, so when S is finite but large, somehow you will get closer to hard spheres. Now, when S is smaller, you see that the repulsion of the points will be weak or weaker. However, the decay at infinity will be slower. So the effect is that the points, they will repel less, but on the other hand, they will see more points around them, they will interact with more points, and this will have the effect of increasing the rigidity of the point process. So there are some natural thresholds in this model. The first is S equals D, the dimension. And this has to do with integrability of the potential V. So you see when S is larger than D, then the potential is non-integrable at the origin, but it is integrable far away. And when I go below D, then it's reversed. The potential is integrable at the origin, but non-integrable at infinity. So S equals D will play an important role in our study. And of course, there is S equals 0, which is another threshold for this model. Which is clear from the definition of the potential. However, you will see later that S equals minus 2 will also be a natural threshold. Okay, so I hope you have recognized some of the point process you know already. So let me mention that this family of point processes contains many applications in many different areas, both of physics and mathematics. And furthermore, this point process is expected to be somewhat universal, which, by the way, explains why it appears everywhere. So in physics, S larger than D is sometimes called the soft sphere gas because of what I told you, that when S goes to infinity, you get the hard sphere gas. And it's used in practice to describe many interesting physical systems. If you work in random matrix theory, you probably know the case S equals 0, so the log, in dimension 1. In this case, the point process is sometimes called sine beta, and it describes the local behavior of eigenvalues of some random matrices. The value of beta depends on the kind of matrices you study. So, for instance, if you study GUE, then beta is going to be equal to 2. If you study GOE, then beta is going to be equal to 1. The same sign 2, actually, or sign 1, also describes the local behavior, or is believed to describe the local behavior of eigenvalues of random Schrödinger operators. And by the way, let me mention that sine beta is also completely equivalent to a zero temperature quantum gas. So the temperature is zero. However, the gas is quantum with the Laplacian, with the interaction which is indicated on the slide here. So anyway, so sine beta, or if you like, the 1D log gas is a very important family of point process for S equals 0. In dimension 2, the log gas is also very important, and when beta equals 2, it also describes some family of random matrices, actually the G-NIME. But more generally, when S is D minus 2 in any dimension, it's really the Coulomb gas. Coulomb gas, just because the potential Vs, which I defined in the previous slide, is really just the Coulomb potential, if you like, the fundamental solution of the Laplacian, the guy which solves minus Laplace V equals delta. The Coulomb gas has many different names in the literature. It's sometimes called the Jellium, it's sometimes called the Plum Pudding Model, the one component plasma, the homogeneous electron gas, the uniform electron gas, the renormalized energy. All this is the same, okay? Although sometimes a slightly different definition is used, and one should prove that the definition gives the same point process as the other definitions. And at the moment, I think we do not have proof for all the cases, maybe. But anyway, it should be the same point process, and it describes interacting charged particles like electrons in a metal or the ionized atoms in the core of white dwarfs. It was also actually used back in 1904 by Thomson as a model for atoms, but it was very soon discarded when the structure of atoms was better understood a few years later. Okay, so that's the Coulomb gas. It's probably the most important physical system, so S equals D minus 2. Now you see, if you look at real electrons and you confine your electrons to a plane or to a line, they will still interact with a three-dimensional Coulomb potential, 1 over x, so S equals 1. So S equals 1 is also important in dimensions 1 and 2, and for the same reason, S equals 0 is also important in dimension 1. That's a 2D Coulomb gas, which is restricted to a line. So I think for many, many years, there were many people working on these different point processes, although, I mean, I suppose that each community has its own value of S and D and beta, maybe, and maybe people were not discussing with each other enough, and it has only been realized recently that it's very useful to put all these examples into a unique family parameterized by S, and I will try to argue in this talk that actually understanding some S could in principle tell us of what's happening at other values of S. So what are the main questions for these cases?
Mathieu, can yes. I ask something?
Of course.
It's Nicolas Rougerie. Hi. I was just wondering, what do you mean by equivalent when you say sine beta is equivalent to, I guess, Calogero-Sutherland, you're saying?
Yes.
What does it exactly mean, equivalent?
Equivalent, well, it depends on which situation you place them. So, but for instance, if you place your gas in a confining harmonic potential, then they are just equal. Okay. Exactly equal. This is what Sutherland and Calogero did. So if you look at the ground state of your quantum problem, you take the square, then it's exactly equal, okay, to the P of sine beta in the harmonic potential. Exactly equal. It's an equality, it's a computation.
Okay.
Or if you like, the square root of the probability for your n points in a harmonic potential is the ground state of the quantum problem.
Okay, thanks. It doesn't look obvious to me, but...
No, it's not an easy... I mean, they wrote books about that. I mean, if you do the computation, it takes maybe 4 lines. Once you know, it works, but it's
okay.
A computation. So I like this interpretation, and also, I mean, because, so that's the interaction here. I mean, you see that beta equals 2 is special. I should have mentioned this. Beta equals 2 is special because the quantum gas has no interaction whatsoever, so it's just the usual free electron gas. And by the way, they are fermions because you see if beta is larger than 2, strictly larger, then you have this very strong 1 over x squared potential. which forces your wave function to vanish when two particles are on top of each other, so they are really thermals.
So yeah, so I was going to ask, when you mean you just, it's just the bosonic ground state of this guy with harmonic, I mean, inverse x squared interaction, but it's the bosonic ground state of this one.
Yes, but I think bosonic fermionic doesn't really make a difference because the potential is so singular that the wave function will vanish and its sign you can choose as you like, I think.
Maybe, yeah, okay.
Something
well,
like
thanks
that.
anyway. It's good to know.
Okay. I think it's a useful interpretation. I don't know if it's useful to prove theorems, but I like the interpretation. Okay, so here is the list of questions, which I think, yes, there was a...
About the definition of the Coulomb gas, one thing is not clear for me. So you look at the Gibbs measure given by what you...
I mean, I will give the definition. I mean,
it comes later, okay.
Yeah, I'm just talking. Well, I will just describe the general philosophy and then I will define things properly, or at least I will try.
Thank you.
Okay. So here is the list of questions, which I think from the point of view of statistical mechanics, one should look at. Okay. And so the first natural question is to maybe be a little bit, I mean, not try to do too much, namely, do not yet consider the point process, but at least show the existence and properties of some macroscopic observables or quantities like energy, entropy, and so on, per unit volume, number of particles per unit volume, these kind of things. Okay, so in this case, one tries to just give a meaning to some real numbers, which are, if you like, expectation values of your point process, but per unit volume. Okay, and study this property, these quantities in terms of the parameters of the model, namely beta and rho, or if you prefer, beta rho to the S over T. Of course, the next and important question is to try to construct the point process itself. Okay, that's very important, by doing some kind of limit. Okay, one can answer the first question without answering the second question. And of course, we would like to characterize this point process. I mean, one can always do some kind of weak limits, or I mean, abstract compactness arguments, but it's better to actually characterize it better. And there are two ways of characterizing the point process, either by a minimization principle or by the fact that it solves some equations. So let me stress that minimization principle is very good and it's probably the best way as soon as you have finitely many points, or if you like, you work at finite volume, because it gives uniqueness and everything is unique and there's no question whatsoever of what is the probability you are studying. However, in the limit when n becomes infinite, so when you really look at your point process in the whole space, it's not always so clear to give a meaning to a useful minimization principle. Often you have to restrict yourself to special classes like stationary point processes and so on, and then you lose a little bit the general structure of the whole set of point processes. Equations, so there are many famous equations like DLR, Kirkwood-Salzburg KS, BBJKY, KMS. In principle, all these equations should be equivalent to each other. So if you have a point process which solves one of these equations, it should also solve the others. However, I mean, not everything is known at the moment, and it's quite difficult to prove such a statement. Of course, uniqueness is a very important question. As soon as you have infinitely many points, as you should do, then actually, so I wrote G of DS beta rho, but it's really a class of processes. More precisely, it's actually a convex set of point processes. There is no reason that this set should be reduced to just one point. Okay, so for given values of your parameters, there might be several point processes and not a unique one. Of course, by averaging, maybe you could restrict yourself to some special averages, like if you want to assume translation invariance, for instance, you by averaging, you get one translation invariant process, but in general, the interesting set is a convex set. The fact that it's not a unique point, but it's a convex set, a non-trivial convex set, is related to phase transitions. So one says that there is a phase transition when the set changes, the structure of the set changes, for instance, goes from just one point to a non-trivial convex set. And I think the general conjecture which everybody has in mind is that anyway, even if it's not just one point, it should anyway be unique modulo isometries of space. I think this is what it means to have a phase transition or a symmetry breaking phenomenon. So if you like, you have a convex set, but then the extreme points, you can, if you give me one extreme point, then by applying isometries like translations, rotations, I can get all the other extreme points of my convex set. Okay, so that's the phase, what I call the phase transition conjecture. So it's unique modulo natural symmetries of RD.
Okay.
So the typical example you should have in mind is when space translation is broken. So think in dimension one, for instance, a typical example is when your point process is periodic, but it has a real periodicity, say period one. Okay, so you have a periodic point process. For instance, think of putting the points exactly on a lattice. That's a periodic point process. Then I can translate this periodic point process as I like. And by doing this, I get a convex set with respect to translations. There was a question.
So the convex set is constructed from the actual set. You have a family of point processes that you take all convex combinations to construct the convex set, or
no? My family set is going to be automatically convex.
Okay, so by definition.
By definition, it's very vague so far, right? I'm doing a list of what I think should be proved. Now, very few of all these points have been really proved. Okay.
Okay. Sure.
But this is the general structure I have in mind and which I think should be the case. And once you have defined your point processes and they form this convex set and blah, 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 of course, you want to study them, understand them better. There was a very nice lecture by Milen Maida last time about rigidity. So that's one very typical question you want to ask on these point processes. Of course, you can ask many other questions about uniformity. I mean, what's the exact repulsion between your points? What is the decay of correlation, etc.? So, for instance, what is predicted just from the form of the potential is that the repulsion in terms of the two-point correlation function rho 2 should be exponentially large when S is strictly positive and should be polynomial when S is zero. This should be true in all dimensions. And beta, you see, is then the parameter. Beta and S together are the parameter which quantify this local repulsion. So now what about mathematical results? I think that all these questions have not been answered for one value of S, D and beta. So there are some point processes which are very well known and understood, like sine 2 for beta equals 2, which is a determinant of point process. We know everything about it, but still, I think that I will always find one point in this list of questions which has not been fully understood. I think one should try at least to solve these questions for the simple cases like sine 2 or sine 1 and so on and so forth. Maybe the most complete picture actually is for the 1D Coulomb gas, which is S equals minus 1 and D equals 1, which has been solved by a very nice paper by Kunz in 74. So he solved many of these questions, but I think he did not discuss equations. So there is still a lot of things to do. Okay, so now I will try to tell you what's known about these questions. And it will be much easier to start with S bigger than D, even if I suppose that most of you are interested in S equals 0 or maybe S equals D minus 2. I mean, I think we should first understand the easy cases before going to the more complicated ones. And as you will see, not everything is understood even for large S. But before, I think I have to make a quick clarification about the limit. So actually, in many practical situations, the point process is obtained after doing some zooming procedure in a dense set of points. So it's exactly the case of random matrices. So you have some eigenvalues, and it's exactly like these eigenvalues being confined by an external potential x squared. And then the macroscopic density of the eigenvalues is typically the semicircle law, like I have displayed in red here on the right. Okay, so the density of points is just a function, if you like. And what you have to do is then to choose one point in the bulk and then zoom. And then around this point, there will be many, many points. So you have to zoom at the proper scale. And then once you zoom, then in the limit, you will see the point process leaving on the whole of R in this case, or the whole of RD, okay, after doing some limit. This is not what I will be discussing here. I will not discuss what is happening when you put an external potential or if you change the external potential and so on and so forth. I think this zooming procedure should work for all reasonable confining potentials, and there are many recent works about this problem. But the reason that you always get the same point process when you zoom is just because it's a scaling invariant. It has the correct homogeneity, so you can always get this one. So the talk, the lecture, will only be about the infinite point process living on the whole space. There will never be any zooming about a dense set of points in an external potential. Okay. However, I will have to construct this point process. So I will have to do a limit, but I will do a more homogeneous limit, if you like, where I will think of the density of point being essentially constant over a large set, but the density will not vary. Okay, so I will start by describing what's known in the short range case S bigger than D, which is what people have done in statistical mechanics starting in the 60s. Also, because I think maybe it's not in the background of most people working on in random matrices and for S equals 0 typically, or other values of S. And I think it's very useful to know what is happening at large S, because actually we expect that the exact same should, or almost the same, should happen at smaller values of S, except that it's much more complicated to prove. Okay, so I will start by just a short crash course in statistical mechanics. So you see what we want to do is to construct a point process fixing beta, which is 1 over the temperature, and fixing the density. But as I told you, actually the density, we can fix it to be equal to 1 if we like, by scaling invariants. You have to realize that in statistical mechanics, the spirit is that you always have a choice of the parameters you want to fix, and fixing rho and beta may not be the easiest. So what people like to do is choose some easy variables or parameters which you can fix, work for these ones, and then show as a second step that you get some information when you fix beta and rho. This is what is called the equivalence of ensemble. And in mathematical terms, it's just about Legendre transforms of convex functions. So what is the general procedure? The procedure is the following. You are going to minimize the free energy, which is E minus TS plus PV minus mu n, fixing three parameters which you choose. And once these parameters are fixed, then there are many of the terms that you can erase just because they are fixed, they don't matter anymore. And then you take the volume or the number of points to infinity in order to obtain a point process on the whole space parameterized by the remaining parameters. In this free energy, E minus Ts plus PV minus mu n, so E is the energy, S is the entropy, which is here to, to quantify the amount of randomness, V is the volume of your system, and N is the number of points. All the red quantities are microscopic extensive quantities. So extensive means that when I increase the number of points, they will all diverge. They will all behave like the number of points. So I have to divide by the volume or divide by N if I want to get a limit. On the other hand, I have three other parameters which are the dual parameter to the other quantities in the sense of Legendre transform. So the temperature is the dual to the entropy, the pressure is the dual to the volume, and mu is called the chemical potential, and it's the parameter which is dual to N. So you have to think that if I start to fix T, P, N, or mu, then by then varying them, I will be able to get an average N as I like, or an average volume as I like, or an average S as I like. So in practice, what you do is to really fix three quantities, then minimize. This gives you a probability measure. And then you take the limit N or V to infinity. In real life applications, one usually want to work in the isothermal isobaric ensemble, which means that you fix N, the pressure, and the temperature. So let me remind you just the famous phase diagram of water here, which expresses, if you like, the structure of your point process in the limit, depending on the value of the pressure P and the temperature T. Okay, so you know that at room temperature, at the usual room pressure, water is going to be a solid when the temperature is less than zero. It's going to be a liquid to 100 degrees Celsius, and then it's going to be a gas. Okay, the fact that it's either a fluid or a solid has to do with the structure of your point process, namely whether it's just a unique point or whether it's a convex set. So in the solid phase, space symmetry or translational symmetry is going to be broken, and you will really have a non-trivial convex set. So isothermal isobaric is actually real life, if you like. Okay, however, it may be difficult to study your point process in this ensemble, and people like to work with other ensembles. So there is typically the NVE, the NVT, or the μVT. We actually like to work in the canonical ensemble where you fix NVT. Okay, so V is the volume, N is the number of points, and T is the temperature. So if you fix NVT, then PV doesn't matter anymore and UN doesn't matter anymore. So you just minimize E minus TS. And then you take the volume or N to infinity. And what you do is you fix the density, the average number of points per unit volume. So you fix rho, which is N divided by V. Okay, and in this way, you end up with a point process, or you should end up with a point process depending only on rho and T. Okay, and in the grand canonical ensemble, you do not fix the number of points, but instead you fix its dual variable, which is called mu. And I will discuss now canonical and grand canonical for our example. So let's do it. So as I said, let us fix an average number of points per unit volume. So let us fix rho. We can take it to be one in our case if we like, but let's keep rho. And let us fix a beta, which is 1 over t. Now we take n, an integer, and we take a domain which has the correct volume so that we get the correct average number of points per unit volume. So my domain has to have volume n over rho. Okay, so now we have rho, we have beta, we have n, and we have a domain. Now in this domain, we just throw points randomly and we look at the probability measure, which minimizes E minus Ts, energy minus T, entropy, which in this example amounts to minimizing the sum of the potential energies, sum over pairs of the potential energies among the points, and the entropy, P log P. Okay, so you see, I mean, P is really a probability on configuration of n distinct points in omega, which I will just identify to omega to the power n. Okay, the Lebesgue measure is used as a reference. So, I mean, when two points coincide, it's just a zero measure. So I don't really care. So I just identify this to omega to the n. And then I divide by n factorial to account for the fact that I have counted the configurations too many times, right? I should count really configuration of points, and the order of the labels, if you like, of the points should not matter. And here is really the energy of these points, which involves my potential V, and I sum over all pairs, and then I do 1 over the distance to the power S. Okay, so that's the average energy of my points when I have some probability P. And that's the average entropy, which is just P log P. I do the same n factorial for the same reason, and then I have a T. So when I actually minimize this over all P, I get the Gibbs measure here, P, which is E minus beta the energy divided by the proper renormalization, normalization constant, which is called Z, and it's called the partition function. Okay, so this P here is the definition of, if you like, my point process, but only when I have n points in a domain omega, temperature T. And then I adjust the volume of omega in terms of n through the relation here. Okay, so that's it's unique, and it's actually the unique minimizer of E minus TS. What do we know about this probability measure? So now it's very important that, so far S could be anything, by the way, but now it's going to be very important that S is bigger than D. When S is bigger than D, then the potential is integrable at infinity. And then one can show convergence when N goes to infinity to a point process. So for that, I have to choose a sequence of domains which grows. And it's actually important that the result does not depend on the sequence I choose, but it should not be too wild, of course. So let me just take omega n, which is just the rescaled version of one domain omega, and you can take any open convex set. If you need volume, it's going to work. So I take any open convex set, like a ball, a cube, or whatever. Then I scale it. I center it at zero, for instance. I scale it. And I do the limit when I fix n over omega n, or I can just make it 10 to my given row. And then, so the first result I want to state is about the existence of the free energy per unit volume. So you see, so I minimize this quantity here. The unique minimizer is the P, which is here. When I compute E minus TS for this P, I actually get minus 1 over beta log Z. It's just an explicit computation, easy that you can do. Then I divide it by the volume, I take the limit, and I obtain some unknown function, which is the free energy per unit volume of my point process. And because of the homogeneity of my potential, this F has some scaling invariance, and it's also given by this expression. Here I can, if I want, decide that rho is 1. Okay, so this is just answering the first question of my list, which is the existence of one extensive quantity. You could also look at the energy, or just look at the entropy, or look at other quantities. I'm just stating here the result for the total free energy. This function here is unknown, right? It's a complicated function. The whole problem is to find it, and it's not easy. We know it's concave in T and convex in rho, and it has also been proved. So now I'm going to the second question of my list, that the point process, I mean that my P converges locally to a point process over RD with density rho. Okay, so I take a domain, a large domain, large ball, if you like. I just put at random with these probability measure endpoints, and then I enlarge my domain. I take n to infinity as well, and I know that up to subsequences, of course, I will converge to a point process. And this point process is our point process and satisfies many nice properties, but I will just tell you which property later. I will remain vague at the moment. Now, so I'm telling you that the first two questions of my list have been answered, but that's only when S is bigger than T. Okay. Correlation functions. Let me emphasize something. Okay, so what is the correlation function for my point process at finite n? So the k point correlation function is given by this definition here. So I look at the marginal of p with respect to all variables but k, and it doesn't matter which variables I choose. Okay, and then I put the same 1 over n minus k factorial for the same reason as before, and that's the definition of my k point correlation function of my probability measure. Now you see, if you just plug in the definition of p, you get the exponential minus beta the energy and divided by z, which is the normalization. And now here we can use the fact that in the exponential we have something positive. So here we have the interaction between all the points, but this sum is certainly larger than if I look at the interaction between the k first and the interaction between the n minus k last, and I neglect the interactions between the k first and the n minus k last. And then I get an upper bound, okay, where I have only here the interactions between the k points x1, xk, okay? And for the n minus k last, you exactly recognize the z of n minus k. So this is certainly less than one. So you see that the k particle, k-point correlation function can be estimated point-wise by the quotient of the partition function for n minus k and the partition function for n. So you see that, I mean, let me show you again. So we would like to have some properties of the final point process. And for instance, we would like to understand the correlation functions. Or maybe we would like to show the convergence of the correlation functions. One natural thing to do would be to prove that these correlation functions are bounded uniformly. And then you would have to show that this quotient here is bounded, which, by the way, is the same as estimating how much the free energy is displaced when you remove k particles or k points from your system. It's not an easy question. And actually, I have to admit that I do not really understand what has been done in the literature, because it's too much on the probability side for me. But it has been studied a lot, in particular by Georgi in the 70s and 80s. And I'm not so sure that we have a very good bounds on the k-point functions in the canonical case. And it's really certainly not easy. So now I would like to explain to you that if you do it in the grand canonical case, it's completely obvious. Just to show you the advantage of working with a different ensemble. And then what you have to do is just to show that ensembles give the same answer. And for this, maybe you need weaker results on the k-point function in the canonical case. So let me go to grand canonical. I know that it's not so well known, but it's a very useful tool. Actually, if you look at the literature in statistical mechanics, then most works will be in the grand canonical ensemble, because it has a very nice algebra. Everything is much easier. And many people do not even dare to show that the canonical will follow from grand canonical. They are just happy with working only with the grand canonical problem without showing equivalence of ensemble, because it might be very technical to show the equivalence. But certainly people expect that by looking at the grand canonical ensemble, you understand everything about your point process. Okay. So let me explain to you what it is. So now we are not going to fix the number of points. We will still take a domain but the number of points is going to be random. Okay, so we allow any number of points in our domain omega, and therefore my probability measure is more a family of measures, of positive measures, each PN telling me what is happening in the event that I have n points. And of course, the sum has to be one just because it's a probability. Okay, so the number of points is random. So now what we do is we fix a number mu, which is called the chemical potential and is the variable dual to the number of particles. And by varying this mu, we will be able to get any average number of points that we like. And of course, we fix beta again. We take a domain omega of a fixed volume V. And now here is the grand canonical probability measure. What is it? Well, because of the recipe I told you, it is just the unique minimizer of E minus TS minus mu n, which are the remaining things which I can optimize in my problem. Now, E is just the sum of all possible number of particles of the previous energies. The entropy is also just the sum. And then you have to be able to compute the average number of points in your system, which is just n times the previous pn over n factorial. So you get a 1 over n minus 1 factorial instead of n factorial. So it's well known, you can also do it as an exercise, that if you minimize this whole line here with respect to all possible probability measures, then you get the one which is given in the blue box. So it's the following. So you see, it's actually the same more or less as in the canonical case. So it's E minus beta energy, except that you have this E beta mu n, which is inserted and depends on mu. And of course, the normalization factor now is the same for all n, doesn't depend on n, and it's given by the sum. Just to make the whole thing normalized, it must be a probability measure. Okay, so this is the grand canonical probability. If you like, it's a little bit a kind of Laplace transform with respect to n of the canonical probability measure. So you sum with this weight. Okay, so that's the grand canonical ensemble when you fix beta and mu instead of fixing beta and n. The k point correlation function is just given by this formula. It's just the sum of the k point correlation functions in the canonical case. And now here comes the magical thing, that if you do exactly the same estimate as what I did in the canonical case, then everything simplifies because of this sum, and you get a completely obvious bound on the k point correlation function. Okay, everything simplifies. It's very easy. Just write it by yourself if you like. And the k-point correlation function is just bounded almost everywhere by E beta mu k, and then E minus beta this sum, which of course is less than one. So you see the k-point correlation function is uniformly bounded independently of the size of your system. And therefore, it's very easy to pass to the limit and get a point process in the whole space, okay, by some compactness argument. Let me show you again, let me go backwards to my list of questions. Let me remind you of the repulsion between the point, which we expect to be like exponential minus beta 1 over x minus y to the s, okay? So you see that we immediately, so in the grand canonical case, whoops, that's here, we immediately get an upper bound of this sort, which definitely shows that the two-point correlation function has to vanish very fast when two points get close to each other. Okay, very good. So you see, grand canonical is just a one-line proof that the k-point correlation functions are uniformly bounded. You can actually show more. So I have copied here an exponential bound on the number of points. It's actually for Thomas because of some discussions we had yesterday. So if you assume that S is bigger than D, Then you have this estimate on the log of the expectation of the exponential of the number of points squared in any cube, okay, which is completely independent of the size of your system. So this kind of bounds is very useful. It's it's a little bit different from the pointwise bound on the k-point correlation functions, okay. And you see, it does not depend on the size of the system. So when you have such bounds, you can easily pass to the limit and get a point process on everything. So here is the theorem in the grand canonical case. So you assume again that S is bigger than D. You assume that your domain grows exactly as before. The minimum free energy is minus 1 over beta, the log of theta. And it has a limit, which now I call G. Okay, so let me show you again the canonical thing. So canonical, there was a limit which was called F. Now there is a limit which is called G. That's the average free energy of my grand canonical problem, which is E minus TS minus mu n. And the relation between F and G is that they are Legendre transformed to each other. So if I know F, I know G. If I know G, I know F. That's the equivalence of ensemble in terms of the average free energy of your point process per unit volume. Because of the nice bounds I show you, you can prove that your point process converges to a point process over the whole space, which has uniformly bounded k-point correlations and satisfies, of course, this exponential bound. So this answers the problem of existence of my point process. And then Georgi has shown that the canonical point processes, so it's not just that the free energies are linked by a Legendre transform. Actually, the canonical point processes are convex combinations of the grand canonical point processes with the corresponding mus. So you see, if you give me a beta and a rho, then by solving this max, there will be some mu's realizing the max. So I know that I can attain a given average number of points per unit volume by adjusting properly the chemical potential mu. And then I also know that the canonical point processes will be convex combinations of the grand canonical point processes of those mu's, which realize the maximum. This is all about equivalence of ensemble. It shows that if you know very well the grand canonical, and if you can prove some kind of weak bounds on the canonical, then there will be equivalence. And everything that you had learned about the grand canonical will go through for the canonical. But the spirit is really that everything is easy for grand canonical, and then it's a matter of showing the equivalence of ensemble. So you see, when S is larger than D, we have answered actually the first two questions completely. Okay, we know that many average quantities converge. We know that there is a point process. We have existence. Now we know more. So these point processes, they actually solve actually the four equations, DLR, KS, BBJKY, and KMS, but I will only speak about two. Actually, I will only speak essentially about KS because I like it more. So the limiting grand canonical point processes, they solve this Kirkwood-Salzburg equations, which form an infinite system of coupled linear integral equations in terms of the k-point correlation functions. Okay, so the k-point correlation functions, they are all linked with each other with these complicated equations. And actually, these equations are also exactly valid when you work in a domain omega. And then you can easily pass to the limit in the equation using the bounds which I have discussed on the k-point correlation functions. Okay, so this is one way of characterizing my point process. So I could look at So now comes for the first time the definition of G, D, S, beta, mu. Okay, and I'm doing it in the grand canonical case. So my parameter is mu, it's not rho, but I know they are more or less equivalent. So What is it? I could define it, for instance, as all the point processes for which the k particle correlation function satisfy the pointwise bounds, which I know must be satisfied. This forms a convex set, and which solve these equations, which are linear, and so I get a convex set this way. That's my GDS beta mu. Okay, this is the definition of the family of point processes, except that, as you can see, I have changed one parameter. It's not the average number of points which I'm using. It's rather the dual variable mu. Now, because you have some explicit equations, you can study these equations. It's been done a lot in the 60s and 70s. And by some fixed point theorem, just Banach fixed point, you can show that if beta is a small, or if you like, if the temperature is large, then there exists a unique solution to this equation. And therefore, there's no phase transition, and your set G is reduced to one point. There's just one point process if beta is small. This you will read in the book of Ruelle, for instance, where you will find this explicit condition. So if E to the beta mu, beta to the D over S is less than this constant here, strictly less, then there is a unique point process. Because it's unique, it's invariant under all the isometries of space. And it actually depends analytically in beta and mu in this region. And because you have equivalence of ensembles, there is also a unique canonical point process. And this condition here corresponds to having rho s over d beta, which was our parameter gamma, small enough. Okay, so when S is strictly larger than D, then we know that at large temperature, if you prefer small beta, the point process is unique. And we can, for instance, characterize it using these equations. It's not the only possibility. You can also use DLR, for instance. And you can also show that DLR is equivalent to Kirkwood-Salzburg, but I think people rather used the Kirkwood-Salzburg to show uniqueness, probably because these are integral equations, and I mean, you can do the Banach fixed point, it's maybe a little easier. Anyway, so this is what is known about the uniqueness of the point process at small beta.
I have a question.
Yes.
So if, what is, is it known that the only possible limiting point, I mean, every solution of that equation is a limit point?
It's a very good question. So you see, this I have not said, and I think it's not right as such. So you have to, I mean, you have to allow a little bit more freedom in the way you do the limit. So the way I did the limit was to take a domain, okay, put points inside and put nothing outside. That's the way I did the limit. Now, if you allow me to put something outside, for instance, I could fix the positions of the point outside, or I could, I mean, reasonable positions, then I can certainly get all possible solutions. And this is the way that people do it. So they if you like, they vary the boundary condition. They do not only look at putting points in a domain and putting nothing outside. They also allow to have some points outside in a reasonable configuration. Okay.
And in that way, you can obtain convex combinations.
And you have to do it in a way that you get a convex set. Yes.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
Okay. That's the usual way of doing it, in particular for DLR. So you see here, I said, I know I get a solution of the equation, and then I define my point processes are being all solutions to this equation. But then you're right, I have to show that I have a way of attaining all these solutions, and it's not clear. I mean, you see the way I did the limit, the only freedom is to change the shape of omega. That's the only freedom I have. And it might not be enough to get all the possible point processes. So, I mean, one has to allow a little bit more freedom.
Would it be interesting to know exactly what kind of point processes you obtain just by changing omega, or is it not interesting?
It is very interesting, but it's difficult. Okay, so if you imagine that your point process will converge to a periodic, so if you like a solid, so if you imagine it will be a periodic, okay, then definitely the shape of omega will play a big role. Right? Imagine that it's periodic, but in a cubic lattice, then if I take a big cube, by choosing the orientation of my cube, I might select one of the final lattices. Okay, but I don't think this has been studied, but I don't know any work of this kind except in 1D.
Okay, great.
Where, of course, everything is easier because there's no rotation. Okay. Let me emphasize that for all S, it's believed, and I know of no proof of this fact. Okay, for these models, or even for other continuous models, I know no proof. It's believed that the set of point processes is probably not reduced to just one point when beta is not small. But this will depend a lot on the dimension. So actually, when the dimension is one, I mean there is this meta Mermin-Wagner theorem, which is more a meta theorem. But so there are results anyway. So when the dimension is one, it has been proved that G will be reduced to one point as soon as S is bigger than two, and for all values of beta. So you see, in dimension one, there cannot be phase transitions. That's what people usually say. This has only been proved rigorously when S is bigger than two, not S bigger than one. But I think it's expected to be true for all S. Okay, so in dimension one, it's going to be always reduced to one point. In dimension two, you have translations, but you also have rotations. And it's known that translations will never be broken, also when S is bigger than two. This has been proved by Frölich and Pfister. However, rotations can be broken. Okay, so your convex set could be non-trivial, but it cannot be because of translations. Okay, it could be because of rotations or because of something else, but I guess people think only rotations should matter in the structure of this set. But it has not been proved that when beta is larger, then it's not reduced to one point. However, there is some clear numerics. So here is some numerics in 2D in a physics paper of 2011. That's actually for the hard sphere gas, so it's when S is infinite, where they definitely found that for the hard sphere gas, there were two phases. So the blue phase is a phase where rotation symmetry is broken. Okay, so the convex set is not just one point. And here they selected some of one specific orientations. You see they all point more or less to the same. The arrows are the correlation functions. I don't know exactly how they draw the arrows, but for each point they look at correlations and somehow what is the maximal direction or something. However, in the green region, then you see the arrows, they point in all possible directions and there. So they have two phases, and then eta here is a rho, actually. Okay, so you see that when eta is large, so which means density large, which means, let me remind you, it's beta rho to the S over D, so which means that it's like beta large, if you like. Then it's blue, so there is a symmetry breaking, but when rho is a bit less, then there is no symmetry breaking. Okay, and I think the exact same is certainly expected for all S, but and I could find some physics papers, but the pictures were less nice, so this is why I'm showing you the case of hard spheres. In dimension three and higher, translation invariance can be broken. Actually, I mean, you know that if you put your water in the fridge at less than 0 degree, it will become ice, right? Ice is just because translation is broken, and it's believed to happen for all S. when beta is too large. Here is a nice simulation. Here is a nice result from a physics paper. So here it's gamma, so it's rho to the beta to the 3 over s, so that's our parameter. And in 3D, there are three natural phases. So the face-centered cubic solid, the body-centered cubic case, and the translation invariant guy. And here it's our parameter 1 over s. So you see that depending on the value of the exponent s, then symmetry breaking, I mean, translation will be broken when the parameter is large. However, you could either get only the FCC lattice, or if S is small, then there is a region where you start to see also the BCC lattice. So there will be several transitions. The structure of your convex set will change several times depending on the value of beta and also on the value of S. Okay, so first in the fluid phase, it will be just one point. Then in the BCC phase, it will be a periodic point process, which then you can avoid over translations and rotations. This is your convex set. And the periodicity will be that of the body centered cubic lattice. And then if you further increase your parameter, you will get FCC, which is also the packing optimal lattice in 3D. Okay, so certainly for all S, it is expected that there will be phase transitions in 3D. And in 2D, there will be, but never translations, but rotations can be broken. Nothing of this sort has been proved mathematically to my knowledge. Okay, so now it's time to go to the long range case. I mean, you see, I've discussed a lot the case S bigger than D, because I think the picture is not so bad. And also, there are still many open questions in the short range case. Now we'll speak about the long range case, where actually very few things are known, except for some very special values of S. Okay, but the general philosophy is that everything I have said for large S should be more or less the same. For small s, there will be phase transitions and so on. Okay. The first thing you have to realize is that if you don't do anything, the point you will not construct the point process by doing the same limit as the one I explained. Okay. And the reason is that the points, they interact too much when they are far away. Okay. So it's due to the slow decay of your interaction potential, which is not integrable and has the effect that every point sees a lot of neighbors, and therefore they repel. Okay, since they repel too much, then the points will not want to form a nice point process over the whole space. What will happen is actually what is in this picture. So when S is bigger than D, you look at the Gibbs state, you do the limit, and the points, they are essentially more or less uniformly arranged. However, when S is less than D, then your points, they hate each other so much that they will try to be as far as possible to each other. And so they will all accumulate at the boundary of your domain. And therefore, if you take the domain to infinity, the points will just all disappear, and you will not have constructed a point process in RD. And it's very well understood what is happening. If S is less than D, I am only stating it for positive S for simplicity, but there is a similar result for negative S. Then the free energy of your canonical system will not behave like N or like the volume. It will instead behave like N to the power 2 minus S over D. Times an explicit number, and this is due to the fact that the points are just accumulating at the boundary. So let me emphasize, so when S was bigger than D, the free energy was behaving like a constant times N, and the constant was only depending on beta. It did not depend on the shape of the domain. However, when s is less than d, then it behaves like n to the 2 minus s over d, and the constant does not depend on beta. So you see the temperature or the beta does not play any role to leading order. However, the constant depends only on the shape of the domain. So anyway, you see it's not working at all. And we have to do something. We have to compensate this very bad long range. People usually call this renormalization. I have to admit it's not a word that I like because, I mean, renormalization is a whole thing in quantum field theory and so on. I mean, we have the tendency of calling too many things renormalization, but anyway, let's call it renormalization if you like. So I will look at the following renormalization. There are several possibilities to solve this problem that the points repel way too much. But I will look at the following, which I think is the best because it's it preserves the homogeneity of the system. So I will do what's called the Jellium, what has been called Jellium, namely, I will add a jelly. I will add a uniform background of opposite charge to my points in order to kind of slow them down like being in a jelly and forbid them to go to the boundary. People like to call Wigner for this idea of compensation. Wigner was looking at the quantum problem, and I think the classical problem which we are discussing here is much older. It is it appears in works by Thomson in 1904, but it's probably even older. I don't know, actually. Anyway, so let me remind you of our potential Vs, which was 1 over x to the s with a sign or minus log. And the energy was before just this first sum over pairs here. What we are going to do is to add this uniform background. Another points, they will also interact with the background, and the background, we assume it has a density rho b. It's a new parameter here. You will see that rho b will be our rho, there will be no choice. But anyway, let's call it rho b. And here is the interaction between each point and the background. And here I'm just adding one constant, which is, I mean, I don't have to add it, but it's nicer. It's the self-interaction between the background and itself. Okay, so I am just adding these two terms. How should you think of these two terms? Well, you see, I mean, if I take just one point and I look very, and I place it very, very far away, then by putting this, adding these two terms, it's a little bit like doing a Taylor expansion of order two, right? We will have more, I mean, when I look very far away, I will have compensations. And it's a little bit like doing a Taylor expansion, and a Taylor expansion, I will increase the decay of my 1 over x potential. Intuitively, I will increase it by 2, right? Because it's like a second order Taylor expansion. So it's a little bit like replacing 1 over x to the s by 1 over x to the s plus 2. And therefore, the intuition is that we should at least be able to go up to d minus 2, which is Coulomb. Okay, so this trick intuitively should work until s equals d minus 2, but there is a small surprise which we proved or emphasized in a recent paper with Elliot Leeb and Robert Seringer, that actually in any dimension you can go up to s equals minus 2. Okay. So the lemma is the following. You take any s between minus 2 and d, then this energy behaves like a constant times n, if you like, or is thermodynamically stable. I am not going to explain why this inequality is important, but it says that the energy behaves linearly in n. So when s is positive, there's just no constraint on rho b, n, and so on. However, when s is 0 or between minus 2 and 0, then you need to add the constraint that the system is neutral. So namely, the number of particle of points is exactly equal to rho b times the volume. Okay. So you see, when S is zero or negative, then the number of points is constrained. We cannot choose it. Okay. There's no way. However, when S is positive, any value, then the number of points is not constrained. We can choose it as we like. So because of this little lemma, now we expect, or I expect at least, that the point process should exist for all S between minus 2 and D. Okay? Nothing like this has been proved so far. I think most people do not look at negative S. But perhaps I should first explain to you why minus 2 pops in. So it's a new threshold. Minus 2 pops in because if you look at the Fourier transform of 1 over X to the S, this Fourier transform changes signs at all negative even integers. So 0, minus 2, minus 4, minus 6, and so on. So it changes sign at 0, and that's the reason, maybe I go back to the very, very beginning here, that's the reason that we had to put a minus in our definition of the potential for negative S. That's because we wanted to have a positive Fourier transform. Okay? But this is only going to work until minus 2. If you want to go below minus 2, you have to flip the sign again. But then I would not know how to compensate everything with just a background. You would need more, I mean, perhaps things about first moment, second moment, I don't know, which do not look very natural. Anyway, so the model should make sense for all S larger or equal than 2, and it's definitely more complicated for smaller S. However, you see that the canonical model should make sense for all S between minus 2 and D, but canonical, you have to take rho equal rho B, or if you prefer, rho B equals rho. So the number of points has to be related to this background, or if you prefer, the background has to be related to the number of points that you want to put. For this reason, because of the lemma I showed you, the grand canonical model probably does not make sense for negative S because it's not stable. However, it should make sense for all positive S. But if you take a mu and do everything I told you before, you do the limit, you will discover that the limit does not depend on mu. And actually, the average number of points in your system is always rho b. Okay? So one can use the grand canonical formalism for S less than D. However, one cannot vary by moving mu. This will not vary the average number of points in your point process because the average number of points is fixed by the background which you have chosen. This is my expectation, but I think that it has not been proved or definitely not been proved for negative S. So this is a list of what I think has been proved, but please correct me if what I'm saying is wrong. So if you fix beta and rho b or rho, it's the same. Then if S is a positive, the grand canonical free energy converges, and it only depends on rho b. And the dependence in mu is completely obvious. And the average number of points in your system is always rho b. And now in the canonical case, you need to assume that S is larger or equal than d minus 2. In dimension 1, you can certainly add the Kuhn's paper S equals minus 1. I don't know if S between minus 1 and 0 have been studied, and definitely S less than minus 1 have not been studied. Then the canonical free energy converges, and the limits are the same because now there's no Legendre transform because it's just obvious in mu. Okay, so this is now answering the first question of my list for a long-range for these long-range point processes, when S is less than D, one has to do a renormalization. I am suggesting to use this uniform background. And even there, we do not have a full picture about the first question. We only know the first an answer of the first question in some cases. So at least to say that, of course, then the next questions have also not been answered in many cases. So here is a selection. I'm almost done. I have 5 minutes, right? Or seven, maybe. Laura?
You have even eight or...
eight, wow, great. I'm almost done, no?
Wind up to 10.
Thank you. So even in the grand canonical case, which you are free to use, I think, when S is positive, controlling the k-point correlation functions is more complicated because your energy has no sign. So the easy bound I showed you does not go through, and everything is more complicated as soon as you have this very long range. So what is known? So there is an extremely nice recent work by Armstrong and Serfati, who studied the Coulomb case only, so S equals D minus 2, and they proved the same or same spirit exponential bound on the local number of points. And this shows actually that the correlation functions are bounded in L1 uniform but far away from the boundary. And this allows to pass to the limit and obtain a point process. However, you see, it's really a compactness argument in a way. So just knowing that there is a limit is not enough. I mean, we really would like to characterize it by some equation or something. I think that when for other values of S, the best that is known is only that the second moment is locally finite. Thomas will correct me if what I'm saying is wrong. And about equations, there is another very nice work by David de Reude, Adrien Hardy, Thomas Leblé, and Milène Baïda, who proved that sine beta, which is the special case S equals 0, D equals 1, solves a kind of DLR equation properly interpreted because you have to do some kind of renormalization, and which answers, I don't know if it's the third or fourth of my question. So equations, I think, are only known for sine beta so far. I know that David is working with a student to try to extend this to other values of S. There are some works in quantum field theory which dealt with only the Coulomb case in 3D. And they could actually construct by a completely different method the point process and prove it's unique at small beta, together with exponential decay of correlation, using a completely different mathematical theory. So they identify the Coulomb classical point process to a quantum field. And they prove this way uniqueness of their point process. So you see, I mean, it's all the same as for large S. So large S, yes. So we think that for beta small, it's going to be unique, translation invariance, and so on and so forth. And for beta large, there will be phase transitions. There are many works by people around Gruber and Martin in the 80s who studied properties of this point process, assuming it exists and has a nice properties like decay of correlations. So they studied many consequences that one could derive from the existence of the point process, but they could not prove the existence, I think. And finally, there is the very nice Kunz paper, which I like very much. I mean, I really strongly recommend that you read this paper. Kunz studied the 1D Coulomb gas, so S equals minus 1 in dimension 1, and he proved that it's crystallized, so it is periodic for all beta. And it's really just it's just using the Perron-Frobenius theorem for compact operators. It's a very nice work. You can even give it to students as an application of Perron-Frobenius. I like this result a lot. So we have a very good description of the 1D Coulomb gas, S equals minus 1. I would like to mention quickly, I will go very quickly because I have not discussed much zero temperature. I always use the finite beta in the, most of the talk, but let me mention this just to explain to you why I think that understanding large S is useful for small s. So there is the following theorem. So actually in dimension 1, 8, and 24, if beta is infinite, I can always choose rho equals 1, then we know what is happening. We know that the system crystallizes on a lattice that we know. So the energy is going to be this zeta function, which in dimension 1 is the usual zeta, but in higher dimension is what's called the Epstein zeta function. So it's a d-dimensional version of the usual zeta function, where you sum 1 over L to the S over points of a lattice, any lattice. And let me emphasize, you see, this series here does not converge if S is less than d. If S is bigger than d, it's a convergent series. But if S is less than d, it's not. However, zeta is defined by an analytic continuation, exactly like for the usual Riemann zeta, with a pole only at S equals d. Okay, and the theorem says that when S is less than d in those dimensions, then the system crystallizes and the energy is the analytic extension of what it was for large S. So if I summarize the message, this renormalization, or if you like, adding the background, is just doing an analytic continuation in S. Okay, so for this reason, understanding large S actually tells you something about small s, because the small s will be the analytic continuation of the large s, at least in the regions which are linked without having any phase transition in between. Okay, so if I fix a beta and then an s, and then if I move s, and I'm sure that along the way I will never hit a phase transition, then probably what is happening at small s is completely determined by what is happening at large s. Nothing like this has been proved for finite beta, but I think this is a true conjecture. Okay, so now I would like to finish with pictures. So here is the phase diagram of the 3D Coulomb, which is S equals 1, D equals 3. It has the usual phase transitions, where you go from a gas to a fluid and then to a solid in terms of the parameter gamma. Here is a simulation. You even have videos. I was planning to show you the videos, but I have to stop, so I will not. But if you go to this website, you will just see the particles moving. And it's very nice to see. And so you see that the system, so there is this phase transition at about gamma equal 175 in a proper units. Okay. If you go to 2D, for many years, computer simulations indicated a fake first order solid fluid transition. Let me remind you of this Mermin-Wagner meta theorem, which for large S is actually a theorem, and says that translation invariance can never be broken. There are some discussions in the physics literature of whether translation invariance can be broken when S is less than two, in two dimensions. And it seems that numerical calculations confirm that translation invariance can never be broken, at least for S equals zero, so the log gas, and S equals one, which is the 3D Coulomb gas in 2D. However, there will be some kind of complicated Berezinski, Kosterly-Thouless transitions. I will not discuss this. But anyway, so it is expected that rotations will be broken for large values of gammas. And translations will not be broken, but almost, but not exactly. And now I will finish. Here is my last slide about the 1D case. What is known about 1D? Maybe I just comment this picture here. So here we have the line S equals 1. It's a forbidden line. I have not discussed the case S equals D. It's also an interesting case that one can discuss. When S is bigger than 1, this is the short-range case. So we know many things about the point process, which I have described today. It's actually unique. It's believed to be unique, the point process for all S larger or equal than 0. Okay. However, at T equals 0, meaning beta equals infinity, then it's always a crystal. So there is always a symmetry breaking. So the set of my point process is always a non-trivial convex set for all T. And Kunz has shown that it's also broken for all T at S equals minus 1. So you see there is a natural question here. So it is a thought, I think, I mean, it is conjecture that for all S larger or equal than 0, then there will be a unique point process. However, we know at minus 1 it's not unique, so when does the transition happen? Is it a smooth transition? What is happening between minus 1 and 0? I don't know. Now at 0 it's sine beta, it's the log gas, the 1D log gas. It's unique. I don't think it has been proved, but it has to be unique. However, it has a fake Berezinski-Kosterly-Starless transitions at beta equals 2. That's sine 2, the very special integrable DPP point process. And so the nature of this transition is completely explained in a famous paper by Haldane, which I think is not very well known in the mathematical community. So Haldane predicted that the two-particle correlation of sine beta should behave for large r. So there should be a universal 1 over beta, 1 over r squared term. This term is always here. And then there is a non-universal series with some cosines, 2 pi mr with m all integers larger or equal than 1. And a very slowly decaying polynomial here. And so you see that's the nature, the exact nature of this phase transition at beta equals 2. Because what is happening at beta equals 2? Beta equals 2. So when beta is less than 2, when I look very far away, then I only see this term, the 1 over r squared. Okay. So when beta is less than 2, then the two particle correlations of sine beta are exactly 1 over r squared. However, when beta is bigger than 2, then the first term of this series starts to win and becomes dominant. And it has a slower decay, 1 over r to the 4 over beta. Okay. And it has this oscillating cosine. Okay. So if you look far away, when beta is less than 2, you have this this decay. And when beta is bigger than 2, then you have some oscillations, which are however damped with a 1 over r to some power alpha. And you see that when beta goes to infinity, this power is smaller, 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 smaller until it hits 0. And here you are there, 0 temperature, and you have the perfect crystal. Okay, so that's the exact nature of what is happening for sine beta when you vary beta and you look at long range correlations. I think it would be very nice to actually prove this result. There are many computations by Forrester for some beta, but I don't think it has been proved for all beta. I will stop here and I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mathieu. So, do you have questions or comments?
Yes, I have one. Thank you for the talk. I just didn't understand when you spoke about equivalence of ensembles how it's related to Legendre transform. Can you explain it again, please?
Yes. So it's here. Okay, so when you have a convex function, think of that you have a convex function. You know, you can define its Legendre transform, which is, now I never know, I think it's the minimum. I mean, so like this, right? It's usually denoted F star. Okay, so this guy here is the Legendre transform with respect to rho. Okay? And
yes.
When you have a convex function, you know that the Legendre transform of the Legendre transform is itself. So, how is this related to ensemble? So, when you, let me go back to the statistical mechanics crash course. So, you have to think that T, P, and mu are the parameters which you will use in a Legendre transform. So, you always have the choice either of choosing T, and then you will get some entropy that you don't know, which you can compute, okay, or fixing the entropy. For the same reason, you can either fix the volume or fix P and then vary P such as to get an average volume.
Okay.
You see, so you always have this notion of dual parameters, and because it's linear here, when you minimize this, you are really just doing a Legendre transform. The theorem is saying that the Legendre transform passes to the limit, so that if you have solved the grand canonical case, then you can go back to the canonical and conversely by doing Legendre transform. This is only at the level of energy, of free energy. And that's the equivalence of ensemble only if you look at one special, very specific quantity, which is the free energy. Now, if you want to show that the point processes themselves are also linked with each other, it's much more complicated, and it really works by Georgi.
Okay. I think I see it more clearly. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can I ask a question?
So, sure.
Thank you for the talk first. And I wonder, the same questions can be asked for quantum systems, right? For what much is it known in that setting? I don't know, fermions, for instance.
Yes, so you can do exactly all the same for quantum systems, fermions or bosons, by the way. And so actually, several pictures I showed you were for quantum. So let me show you, maybe just one. Let me show you this one, for instance. Oops. So this is a quantum picture. See? Okay. So in the quantum case, there will not be any exact scaling. Okay. So rho and beta now are two true parameters. You cannot choose rho as you like or beta as you like. It will not only depend on beta. Rho to the S over D, because now you have the kinetic energy and the interaction. It's only when S equals 2 that they will scale the same. Okay, so if you are not at S equals 2, then they will not scale the same, and therefore you really have two parameters. And what will happen? So here is a picture. So 1 over RS is actually rho. It's the same. It's a 2D. And here is T, temperature. Or actually, so let me think, S equal, I think it's S equals 1, so this must be square root rho, I suppose. Anyway, so in the classical case, actually, this is given by these two lines. Okay, so in the classical case, you have three regions above the blue line, between the blue lines, and below the blue line, you see? And that's the scaling invariance of the system. In the quantum case, at large density, the kinetic energy, the quantum kinetic energy will start to play a role. And therefore, at large density, it will become really quantum and it will become a fluid again. Okay, so the fact that the phase diagram has this form, so here on the right is really the quantum region. Whereas here, close to the origin, it's actually the classical region. Okay, so quantum is all the same, but more complicated because you really have two parameters now, beta and rho. And then the phase diagram is more complicated. However, there are some results like large rho.
Okay, so, and also we can vary the Planck constant and like do semi-classical or something. H bar
yes.
Post.
Yes, so large rho is actually often going to be semi-classical.
Okay.
And, so there are many works, but most of them for some specific S, and even the existence of what would be what would be the equivalent of a point process, which in the quantum case, I mean, it's not a point process; it's a more complicated object. Actually, it's if you like a state on a C-star algebra. I don't think any other way of defining an infinite quantum state. I don't think that this such a state has been constructed, perhaps only for very large S, but for Coulomb, there's no result like that.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Laure had to leave, so I am taking over as as organizer. Are there more questions?
One last question, maybe. We can also take particles that are positive and negative, or maybe also
yes,
maybe also dipoles and obtain different.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, you can do. Yes, I mean, if you take positive and negative particles in the classical case, it's going to be unstable. So, I mean. For me, I mean, it's important, definitely, but it's a bit less natural because I mean, you have to do something when they are too close, right?
Yeah.
So
maybe
I guess a different way of saying is that there will be a limit on beta and rho.
Okay, sure.
The system will completely collapse if beta is too large. Which is fine. I mean, there are many works. But here I was just concentrating on the simplest case.
Okay, and for instance, to take gravitational instead of repulsion, it's also interesting, or I mean, attraction.
No, that's S equals. You mean changing the sign? Yes, but then you have to stabilize your system also in a way or another. So, so if it's quantum, you can stabilize it using the quantum kinetic energy, but if it's purely classical, you have to do something, right? The system, the point process will not exist as such.
Yeah, except maybe for logarithmic, if you, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, yeah. Thank you.
Okay, if there are no more questions, we can thank Mathieu again.
Thank you.